Happy Friday! It's that time again. It's time for Five Things Friday. I'm so thrilled that you're here with me, and I also want to know, where are the Fridays going? I feel like I blink and it's a Friday again, although I love them because I get to spend them with you. This week on Five Things, I am going to tackle five critical steps that it takes to get a book from up here in my head to bookshelves everywhere. So come back and let's chat about how a book comes from my head to a bookshelf near you. I'm just back from Left Coast Crime, where there were a plethora of panels and talks on just every aspect of publishing, from coming up with concepts to writing long-running series, and I thought this would be a great time to share how a book starts up here, kind of like an idea tapping on my head somewhere, and ends up in actual book forms in a shelf or a bookstore where you can actually buy it. So, let's get right to it. Step number one, the first part of actually writing any book is coming up with the idea or the concept. So I always start with a sketch sheet, and I do this still the old-fashioned way, on paper with pencil, because what I'm doing at this stage is I'm just kind of formulating the idea. I might start with a murder, I might start kind of with a theme, like maybe if I'm writing a Bakeshop mystery, I start with an idea with jewels or a recipe or a time of the year. Maybe it's a snippet of something I read in a magazine or newspaper, or I bumped into a strange deer in town and I thought, okay, there's a starting point. So I start with a sketch and I go through and I rough out kind of the plan, who the victim is, who all the suspects are, what they're lying about, what they're hiding. Hopefully that is all gonna embed red herrings into the story. I look at the setting, I kind of think about like time of year and weather and what else is going on that might impact it. And then I actually write out each three acts kind of in the overarching story plot. So that is step number one, which then takes me into step number two, and that is writing the book. As we've talked about many times on our Five Things Fridays, writing a book takes quite a bit of time. So you don't really wanna see me sitting on my computer just typing away every day 2,000 words. That would be a long and very boring episode of our fun Five Things. But the editing process looks like this. I start with a round of edits. I print out a manuscript and I go through and I start marking it up. That's my very first step after I have worked on the book for months and months and let it sit for a little while. Also included in this editing process is my editor will actually go through and edit line by line. She'll pick out just basic grammatical errors, of which there are always some, even many books later. I know what I'm saying in my head and I'm typing so fast it doesn't always translate to the page. So she's a genius at that. And in this first round of edits, she'll also provide information or insight. You know, so she might say, hey, could you give readers a little bit more backstory about Helen and the professor here, or could you give readers just a touch more background about Ashland here, things like that. So that's kind of phase one. Then phase two of professional edits are copy edits. So a copy editor will go through and go line by line through the manuscript. They'll create sheets, style sheets about, you know, things that are recurring throughout the series. They do these very helpful lists of character names and when each character in the story appears and what page number they appear on. So I might go, oh gosh, you know, I didn't introduce Andy until page like 227, that can't be right. No, don't worry, Andy fans, that's not true. I save all of my copy edits because it's always fun to go back through and look at kind of that evolution. So, first, I've sketched out that idea. Second, I've written the book. It's gone through multiple rounds of my own edits, of my editor's edits, and then of a copy editor's very fine-toothed comb edits, which I so appreciate because it's always great to have a fresh set of eyes on your work. I can't believe how many things my editors catch just in terms of like little mini mistakes, but also things that they do to help strengthen the book. And hopefully then when a manuscript reaches your hands, it's the best work it can possibly be. Number three, page proofs. After the book has been through multiple rounds of my own edits and it's been strengthened by my editor and copy editors, the next phase is page proofs. So this is where the book actually starts to begin to feel like a book. I always get excited when I get page proofs in the mail because I know we're getting close. So a page proofer's job is to actually line up the type. And then my job as the author is to go through line by line and make sure there aren't like paragraphs that are all wonky or words that are falling off the page. It's kind of like one last round of looking at how the book is going to not only look, but making sure there aren't any words or errors at that point in time. So the page proofs then actually start to look like what we see when we see the final copy of the book. Number four, cover flats. Cover flats. I always get so excited. I get this eager anticipation once I know that we're through with copy edits and page proofs, because usually the next thing that shows up in my mailbox are cover flats. Cover flats. I mean, first of all, it's just so fun and exciting to see a cover come to life and actually touch it and see what the back cover copy is going to sound like. This is a cover flat for Live and Let Pie, the last Bakeshop mystery that came out. And for The Pint of No Return, this is the cover flat for it in mass market paperback form that will be out in late June. If you haven't read it, this is going to be a great time to grab a copy. Not only are cover flats just exciting and fun from an author's perspective, but they're also a tool that the publishers use. So they'll have information on the back about sales information for bookstores and information about kind of previous books in the series, where it's set, maybe some notes about me, and that gives booksellers an opportunity who maybe like haven't read the series before to get excited about a book and to know where to place it in the store and all those good things. So that's step four, cover flats. Step number five, advanced reader copies, which are also sometimes referred to in the world of publishing as galleys. So advanced reader copies actually start to look like a book. I usually squeal when I get a box of these on my front porch, and you've probably seen me share them sometimes with readers. These are coveted because usually these go to reviewers and booksellers and anyone like that, bloggers. You can tell it always says on the cover, advanced reader copy, not for sale. So if you ever happen to win an advanced reader copy from myself or any of my other author friends, guard it with your life. There still might be some errors in this version because this is kind of the step before it goes out officially. The paper is usually thinner. In this case, obviously the book is bigger. So when Live and Let Pie actually came out on shelves, it's the mass market size. But these are a way to really, really sink in the fact that this book is coming out in a few months and to get everyone excited about it. Once the book is in advanced reader copy form, I know that we are so close to publication date. And this is where I get really excited because I start to hear from bloggers and reviewers about their thoughts about the book. And then the tingling goosebumps begin because I know a book is about to then hit bookstore shelves for you to pick up a copy. So those are five critical steps that it takes to start with an idea and end with a book on the shelves ready to buy or check out from your local library. Before writing professionally, I didn't know how many people touched a book and how much work and effort and what a team there is behind every writer, you know? So there's my editor, there's copy editors, there's page proofers, there's the entire marketing and publicity team, and then there's the sales team who is getting out there and saying, hey, bookstore, you should try this new series. It's so heartening to know that there's like a whole team of people with me who are cheering on my little books and helping to send them out into the world. And also helping to make them be the most polished and professional product for you, the readers. I just think it's such a gift to have multiple people and fresh eyes look at my work and make it stronger and hopefully make it something that you want to keep reading. So, thanks for joining me for another Five Things Friday. I hope you've enjoyed this little glimpse behind the scenes into the world of publishing and how a book gets made. As always, be sure to subscribe to my page and click the bell so you'll get notified whenever I share new videos. And tell me in the comments, did you know this is how books end up in bookstores? Are there other questions that you have about publishing or the process? Ask me and I will try to answer them here or on another episode of Five Things Friday. Happy reading.